Just lift your hands one more time. The Spirit of God is so sweet. So precious in this place. Thank you, Holy Ghost. I don't know the path you came down to bring you to this place today. I don't begin to even try to understand all the situations, detours, pain, shame, whatever it be. But I know one good thing is in Christ, you're a new creation. You have a great future. And His loving kindness is extended to you without measure. And because of that, you have a right to praise Him. Sing of all the wonderful works that He's done for you. And be optimistic that no matter what you face, you are more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. Amen? You viewing by television right now, in your room, in your office, in the pizza place, wherever you're at, people are viewing from all around the world, some of them in coffee houses across Europe. Some of them hid out in barns. I get testimonies of it in Islamic-led nations. Right where you're at, please lift your hand and, more importantly, your heart to God and just thank Him for all of His wondrous and good deeds concerning you. Concerning you. And I want to be the first to tell you that no weapon formed against you will prosper. And every tongue that raises up to condemn you, you will bring it down with truth. For God is with you to comfort you, to guide you, and to lead you in the paths of righteousness. So be blessed in all you're doing this next year. Amen. Give God one more hand clapping. You can be seated. For some of you who don't know me, I cry like a baby. I'm telling you, and if you know my history, just to let you know a little tidbit, I'm an ex-bull rider. And we could take a good beating. But when I fell in love with Jesus Christ, something inside of me changed. I'd been around church my entire life. I'd been in all two different mainline denominations. I was saved. I had a relationship. I prayed. But there was a day I found Him for me. And I've been forever changed from the inside out. And if God can transform a bull rider like me that was given away and pushed out by my family and my parents, I know He's got a plan for you, and He'll do something great in your days that your mind cannot comprehend. And the word and theme over you will be awesome and great, and it will be celebrated by many. Amen? I could have never imagined that God would give me a wife such as Drup and children such as Caleb and Hecla. I could have never imagined it. I could have never imagined that I would be delivered from Farmersville. Nothing good comes out of Farmersville. There aren't even farmers in Farmersville. And I certainly could never imagine that God would take me all over the world with the message of hope for people. But that started at a vision at 10 years old. These men would pull up in front of my little house that was government paid for in Farmersville. Get out of a big black Cadillac. Go and get me. Put me in that car. Put me on a plane and fly me across the United States and around the world to preach Jesus' gospel, the gospel of the kingdom of God. And then they would put me back in that same plane and back in that same car and deliver me back to my mother in this lavish town called Farmersville. So troubled me and shake me at night. I'd wake up crying and I was afraid, 10 years old. So my mom said, "Something's wrong with you, son. You must go to the pastor." I think she thought I needed deliverance. And so I went to my pastor, very limited in understanding. And all he said was, "Just go home and pray about it." And I thought, Pastor, I've prayed so much about it that this is troubling me. And then I remember one day, he changed and he said, maybe one day you're called to preach the gospel. I thought, oh my God, I don't want to wear polyester and a big fat necktie and like that light blue colored suits. You know, back then the flower disco print was, I want to look like one of those guys with the platform shoes. Right? But, and little did I know years on down the road that God would speak to me and say, that I've given, you need to share with many. And then I literally went to my pastor again. And he said, Darren, just be ready Sunday night. God already told me. And I went, there's no way, you're a Baptist. He said, God told me you're called to preach his gospel and to go all over the world. So be ready Sunday night. Then I was scared to death. It's like, what the heck am I going to say? You know, I know John 3:16. I know the book called Possums, Psalms. Okay, true story. First time I preached, I said, turn your Bible to Possums. True story. People looked at me like, he is hillbilly. Okay. But here's why I want to talk to you about your gems. See, it doesn't matter where you're at. It doesn't matter what has unearthed you and encapsulated you. It doesn't matter the shame or the pain that has surrounded you. Like Jonah, when you have a destiny in God, he will get you there. It may come by way submarine, whale, big fish, but you're going to meet your final destination. Amen? Sometimes we get troubled over the things that are beyond our control when we need to focus what is within our control, which is obedience, celebration, and rejoicing along the journey. Amen? It may cost us something, but I can assure you this, whatever it's costing, it is not in comparison to the great outcome that's in your future and the harvest of many souls for God's glory that is going to be left in your wake. I'm telling you it right now. Amen? I'll never forget when God would use me and I would start to prophesy in our bedroom. I would be in, check this out. I would be prophesying in my underwear right before we'd go to bed. Drop and I would pray. You know, that was the Christian thing to do. You bow by your bed and you pray together as a couple, because we heard the couple that prays together stays together. And we were planning on being together a long time. So we thought, we'll try this one. And then something started happening to me. I couldn't sit on my knees no more. I started to get up and prophesy things and it would fly out my mouth. I'm thinking, my wife thinks I'm nuts. She's going to leave me now because I'm going crazy. But I would start speaking out things that we are walking in today and our kids are living out in the earth. It scared me. I'll never forget, I was horrible at geography because I was too busy passing notes to the girls and trying to pass a snuff can across to my buddies. True story. And I remember when God spoke out of me, the region across Canada, the different regions, and the seat of authority in the region. He starts saying, if you will just speak revival, I can release it from heaven. And my wife would just write. I thought, I'm losing my mind. God, nobody prophesies in their underwear. But she would go back and she'd look and she would go, Darren, it's right on. Look at the map. I know you, you're my husband, you're just stupid. But check this out, God spoke so precise. And this is no lie, I'm not fabricating this at all. This is straight on gospel. And I started to see that there's a greater power and authority that works in our lives if we'll lend ourselves to it with a pure conscience. And God can use somebody to do something beyond their comprehension. Some of you may feel what you do is so insignificant, but it is only insignificant to the human eye, because from the heaven's eye, it's mighty and great in the earth. He says, I do nothing unless I reveal it to my prophets, and it's released and spoken out of their mouths. And that was held up in the Old Testament for a select few, but through the new covenant of Christ, it says we all are prophets. Our sons and daughters shall prophesy according to the book of Joel. And guess what? You're one of those. You're a prophetic generation. You have insight beyond the natural human intellect into spiritual things, into great things that God wants to do through people on the earth. See, he looked to the animal kingdom and he went, the best this can be is a zebra. And he looked at Adam and he breathed into him. Totally different specimens of creation. Think about that. Hecla and I was talking about intuition and intellect and instinct. And I said, let me tell you what man's instinct is. It's first breath, this thing called creation. It's first realized oxygen came from the mouth of God. Think about that. The divine expression of God was realized in this hump of creation called Adam. The intellect, the wisdom, the reasoning capacity, the ability to instinctively choose this versus that and make the right decision is in you. No matter what grandma said or grandpa, it's in you. Because the Spirit of God, the seed of God, is resident in you. Therefore, you are more than an overcomer. Therefore, you have wisdom beyond your years. Therefore, you are highly favored of the Most High God. And therefore, you shall not live in fear, but in peace and faith. Amen? And this is how we've lived our life. I've been in some 18 nations to preach. But I've been in over probably close to, 180 through television and internet and everything else? 200? I don't know. I think there's like close to 200 nations. I think we're everywhere. Today we're going to 130 nations through broadcast television. Look around the room. We're like the David against the Goliath. Amen? But praise the Lord, God will get the glory and win in the end. Amen? And that is really what matters. The message he gave me this morning on Sunday nights or Saturday nights, I sleep on the couch. So just in case you hear rumor, that's true. I sleep on the couch. And the reason being is because my Saturday nights are unique. The family goes to bed. I'll fall asleep watching the news or some TV or something. And about 3 in the morning, God starts speaking to me. And it's just like I'm talking to you. It's as clear as vivid. And I'll try to sleep, but I hear him like talking to me. There's times I get upset about this. And I hope for you it's totally different, because this is just interesting in my life. But I'll say, God, could you like wait until tomorrow? True, because I'm tired. I like to sleep. I'm like you guys. I like to sleep. True story. I'll say, God, I'll be asleep. Could you just like hold it? You know, I know you don't forget anything. Just hold this one. True story. So I can rest. But by 3:30, I think this morning, I woke up and I just thought, well, I can't wrestle no more with this. So I got my Bible out and I started putting some things together. And God, you know, I don't understand why you just can't, the word now is download. I don't know why he can't download, upload, inload, ingest. I don't know. He just gives me like a word, Jim. Like, okay. One. True. See, the Bible talks of a word of knowledge. And sometimes we get the words of knowledge. Those are good too. But sometimes God can unpack a word and it will have great meaning in your life. And he gave me this word, Jim. Gems. And I'm going to give that to you in just a minute. You're all gems. Matter of fact, let me just jump ahead. I just can't wait to say this one. You're all gems. Watch. You're buried treasure waiting to be discovered. You've got some intrinsic value in you that people can't see. Even pastors can't see. You want to know why? They look through the human eye. But God doesn't look through the human eye. He looks by his Spirit into your heart and sees great things which are still yet to come. Some of these things are so big, they're beyond you. But this is why it will take faith. This is why it will take hope. This is why it will take input greater than yourself and intellect and wisdom greater than you have. So my question is can we increase our capacity to carry? Amen? Turn to your neighbor and say, you're a gem. Now, if you're sitting by your wife, your fiance, your girlfriend, that's a good word to you. Amen? She's like, Pastor, say it one more time. Yeah, that's right, you're a gem. Yeah, you're a gem. Yes? Oh, do I need some? Hold on, I had a blowout, I think. Amen. Thank you, sir. Amen. Can we tape my eyelids up? I look like Jack Nicholson. Ever dance with the devil in the pale moonlight? No. Amen. So this is how God uses me. Now, I let you understand that because, or share that with you, because God's going to use you in a unique way. It may not be template like someone else, and that's all right. But as you get to know God, and you get to allow God to get to know you even greater, and koinonia with you, communicate with you, and fellowship with you, it may kind of look like it's getting off a charted course, and that's all right. Now, I'm so glad that I started wearing pants when I prophesy so I could come and be amongst people. I mean, you're thankful for that too, huh? On occasion, my wife says, where's that nude prophet I used to know? No, I'm teasing. Have to edit that one out. Anyway, but this is how it started with me. And I remember going to leaders and trying to share, but they were very shallow by application. By insight. And so I had to learn how to walk this out and get scripture on and go to the word to literally get peace of mind concerning how God was grooming me and growing me. And I don't know why I'm saying this. I don't even know why God gave me this message other than for you guys or somebody viewing by television. But put this in your notes, Jim or Jims. It simply means this. It's a person. All this was given to me by, I don't know, 4 or 5 o'clock. I finally went back to sleep. Hecla came in. Dad, what are you doing? Well, I was getting a message from God. She goes, great, I'm going to go on a walk. Okay. Watch this. Jim means this. A person held in great esteem or affection. A prize of beauty. Or worth a precious stone. When you say that you're a prize of beauty to men, they're going to look at you and go, okay, all righty then. But men, you're part of this also, because in a moment I'm going to show you how or where this comes from in Scripture. I'm going to reveal to you a hidden tribe of Israel, one of the 10 hidden tribes. I don't know if you've ever studied any history, but that. Some of you may, and there was a tribe that was lost because of a Assyrian Inquisition. And so, anyways, I don't want to get ahead of myself. So let's talk about Jim from this perspective. Greatly esteemed members. See, I believe there's greatly esteemed members of the body of Christ that aren't always visible. They're not always out front. They're not always favored. They're not always the flavor of the month. They don't always have the book on the best book-selling shelf. Their CD isn't the CD of the month. Sometimes they're not even known about. But their works are in the inward parts. The inward workings, the behind the scenes. And they literally have an incredible job responsibility. That we all feed from, that we all receive from. Watch this. Usually behind the scenes are hidden treasure to be valued and esteemed of great importance, but they don't seek it. My pastor taught me, Darren, whenever you come into a meeting, never prefer the preferred seat. Sit where you can. Then whenever those around you call you forward, it means all the more. He said, Darren, I want you to be a person that prefers others over yourself. I'm thinking, what the heck are you teaching me, Pastor? How to become a doormat? Been there, done that by 2,000-pound bulls. I thought I was redeemed, not recycled. But he taught me some valuable lessons. And I didn't know later on I would be put in front of people of great value, esteemed highly, and I would know protocol and how to function around them without being intimidated and fearful. and also mutual respect would come out of it. These are things sometimes that can be taught, but a lot of times they got to be caught. Amen? Put this in your notes. To be valued and esteemed of great importance. To discover, what's this? To discover comes by knowing them and where they come from. Everybody has a story. And that story is valid and valuable because it was the avenue that brought them to the cross section with you. If we can understand that people have value, even if they're not in our social group or our clique, it does not mean they're not valuable in the eyes of God. Amen. It means that you and I must be more mature and discover their value, their gifting, and their qualities. Does that make sense? This is what I want to do more of this next year. Amen? Put this in your notes. Even the smallest of stones create ripples when thrown into a great pond of water. Something so insignificant. You pick up a stone and it seems so meaningless on the seaside, the lake shore. But when you throw it, it ripples. It has impact. You may feel so small, but never allow that to discount your impact. When you're preaching the truth, when you're living the truth, when you're exemplifying the truth in the community. You are a light of hope. A beacon shining in the darkness. Amen? And we've got to realize that it's the greater one in us that's living through us. So I always say like this, be careful where you take Jesus. He doesn't always want to go where you go. Amen? Praise God. Put this in your notes. You may feel as a small mustard seed, but you can have mountain-moving faith. I mean, I bet the mustard seed feels pretty like shrimpy when he's sitting alongside an avocado seed. Be like, he's really blessed. Right? Think about that. But think about the avocado. The only way you get to the seed is you chop up everything around him. The mustard seed just gets planted and grows into a big tree. Perception is everything. Sometimes you look at your neighbor and he looks like Mr. Big, but you don't understand how he's getting sliced and diced every day because he doesn't have peace with God. Amen? All the more we should pray for them, help them. Proverbs, watch this, 3:15. Look what this verse says. Thank you for tuning into the One We're Now broadcast. I'm Pastor Dr. Darren Goodman, and I hope that this message is having an impact on you. I have to trust that the Word of God is accurate. It's sharp. It's two-edged sword. And it's going to pierce and divide the flesh from the spirit. More importantly, I believe it will help you and benefit you. Amen? Praise God. Watch this. Proverbs 3:15. She, speaking of wisdom in context here, is more precious than jewels. That's our gem. More precious than jewels. And nothing you desire compares to her wisdom. See, wisdom is available to all, crying out to all, and not always received by the multitude. But those that grasp her, those that entreat her, those that entertain her, those that welcome her, how great they can be grown. Amen? Wisdom. Wisdom. Now, wisdom is different than knowledge. Wisdom can be imparted. Wisdom can be found. Knowledge must be exercised. Information put in, acted upon, can equal wisdom. But there's something when God just imputes wisdom into you or I that is so supernatural. A spirit of wisdom. Just like a spirit of faith. You can have faith, but when there's a spirit of faith, it just gets catapulted. It's like faith on steroids. Amen? It's like, bam, it's big. Amen? And so a spirit of faith can enter you, so can a spirit of wisdom. Amen. Joseph had a spirit of wisdom. He was buried in a prison cell. But watch, the spirit of wisdom cries out your name and heralds you throughout the community. Amen. So you have to be released. Why? Because people in the world need what you've got. One time God spoke to me and said, Darren, it's easy. Here's how you can get to the heart of man. Because men are greedy by nature. Play to their greed and you'll never have a need. I'm like, should I? Well, that's pretty good considering I'm a financial advisor. Everybody that invests in the market, there is an element of greed in them. They want to increase. And I always find people say, tell me where I can invest $1,000 and be a millionaire in the next 12 months. I happen to ask my wife. I always tell them California State Lottery. Right, Chuck? Chuck hangs out with me, my friend. But think about it. I've had people say, where's that next limited partnership? I can invest a little bit and it'll become great. Or what about this currency? I like this one. This currency, I have to be careful now. This currency is going to be blah, blah, blah. And they're going to la, la, la. And I'm going to be worth a gazillion dollars in my future. I always say, praise the Lord. Just so like you've arrived, brother. Amen. Come on. But God gave me a very profound word, which was, Darren, in the human nature is greed. So if you play to their greed, you'll never be in need. That's interesting. See, God can turn the heart of a king in his hand. And through wisdom, you can have the wisdom and the insight or the secret to turn the heart of a king in God's hand. Amen. See, not everybody has to like you. And you don't have to like everybody. But you've got to know how things work in the earth so you can reap the benefits. Does that make sense? Amen? Put this in your notes. Gems have insight. They prepare for the well-being of others and the future. We could call this prophetic insight. Amen? The reason being is when we talk of gems, there's a kind of a signet of value. Here, whenever this verse is talking about she wisdom, it speaks of wisdom in the feminine sense. And the reason I believe is because when you study the Hebrew word for wisdom, it says something to this effect, that it's to be embraced. It's something that's fragile. It's something to be cared for. So valuable that you just don't throw it out to everyone. Does that make sense? You coddle it. You cuddle it. You date it. Wisdom. Amen. Amen. Let me show you an example of Jesus. Is this good so far? Let me show you an example here. Jesus assembles. Let's go to Luke chapter 19. He's assembling the multitude. They're coming to hear about the great kingdom of God. They're coming to hear about the insights of the kingdom of God. They had religion, but this man spoke differently than the other rabbis or priests that they were accustomed to. He spoke of a greater insight. And what was unique about his insight is it took the person of least value and attributed the greatest of worth to them. I don't know. I want to just go and cry right now. I say this on occasion, but I really mean it. I don't know how to express myself. I would just be happy if you guys right now just left and I just got to stand here and cry. Keep a tender heart towards God. Amen. Keep a tender heart towards Him. Yes. The reason being is sometimes we get puffed up in manliness and these egos and all of this stuff. Keep a tender heart towards God. He really knows you. Amen. Amen. He really knows you. And it's okay to be tender, moldable, pliable, flexible when you're in the hand of God. Luke 19:39. Look at this. This is a great passage. Now the scene is Jesus is teaching and his disciples are getting excited about what they're hearing. Ever been in church like that? Amen. Preach it, Pastor. Amen. Get them. Sick them, Pastor. Right? Amen. Getting excited. Amen. Well, this is going on the hillside, but there was a mixture of people there that day. And along with those that were on the outside, there were those on the inside of modern religion, and these were the Pharisees. Now, the Pharisees were a unique tribe of people. The reason being is they were fair, you see. They were fair in their own eyes. Their measure of judgment was always fair when it proceeded out of them, okay, away from them. When they judged others, they thought they were judging in fairness, even though their measure was always bent to favor their own group. Does that make sense? So they were fair, you see. And so they're upset because now all of a sudden others on the outside that they don't believe should be close to God, if this is God with us, Emmanuel, they shouldn't have this right or this access to him. He should be reserved just for them, right? Their religious right, if you will. So he's upset because everybody's starting to celebrate his message, because this was a message of inclusion, not exclusion. He was taking buried treasure and uncovering it and showing them their value. So the fisherman's thinking, oh my God, now I'm going to be in the king's court. Amen. The tax collector's thinking, oh my God, guess what? I get to handle more money from a greater king. So everybody, the physician's thinking, now I'm not just working on people in the community. I get to work on the king. So all of them are having many opinions and insights and dreams and ambitions that's swirling around in them like people do. Because now they're all of a sudden on the inside. So they're excited. And so the Pharisees starts to rebuke the disciples. Watch, 39. And some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." See, Pharisees love the rebuke when it's not coming at them. Right? I'd like to have been there the day when Jesus went, "I'm going to rebuke you den of vipers." Amen. Right? So he's being told by them to rebuke his followers. Rebuke your disciples, those that are on the inside with you. Watch what verse 40 says. But he answered and said to them, "I tell you that if these," meaning my disciples, "should keep silent, even the stones would immediately cry out." Let me present something to you, and I'm going to break it down and give you a gem. You want a gem? A nugget? Okay, well, hang on. Watch. So he says, even the stones would cry out. Well, modern day, I like what Kenneth Copeland said one time. He said, do you realize there's actually stone on the recording head of a recorder? So, yep, stones are crying out. Scientists have went and proved that even stones give off a certain type of energy and sounds. Stars, when they're going through the universe, sing. Amen? There was one, I don't know if you knew this, there was a shooting star, and he was singing. His name was Sammy Hagar. I can't drive 55. Amen? Anyways, so if we say stones here, let's just call those stones gems. The reason being is the story I'm about to show to you goes from gems to amber, and that's significant. In a moment I'll show you, and you're going to go, wow, I never saw it like that, okay? And then you want to buy me a coffee. Watch. So my question is, what stones was he speaking of? Some would say the stones that were making up the buildings that were surrounding them, the walls maybe of the great city, those man-erected structures that were within proximity. And that could very well be so. But I found another stone. A stone that is overlooked. The stone that's never talked about. Hold on to that thought. Or did he mean gems? I believe gems for my message. Darren Goodman translation of the New Bible coming out. Or what about this? Is maybe a stone a voice of redemption? Remember the stone that was rolled away? It released redemption, Jesus, when he ascended to the Father. What about that stone? Amen? Put this in your notes, please. To know a gem, you must know where they come from. See, One of the first voices to proclaim who Jesus was came from the priest Simeon. Do you remember that story? Now I'm going to get into the Christmas spirit. Is that all right? So Simeon hears from heaven about this Messiah, Emmanuel, God with us, this God child that would come. He gets inside and he asks him, could I at least see him before I die? And so the angel granted that you'll get to see him before you die. But you're not going to get to talk about it. So he made him mute. Because like most of us men, if we get that kind of insight, we're going to share it with somebody and we have the potential of screwing it up. Right? Ever play that game where you whisper in somebody, I'm going on a trip and I'm going to take with me? By the time it goes around about six of you, it's amazing what you take with you. Right? So God knew what he was doing. So to this preacher, like most of us preachers, you give us this much and we make it that much. He says, no, you're going to be mute. So he went, he couldn't get God's opinion. He couldn't give his opinion to God. He like, done. Anyways, I think that's kind of funny. The second one, watch. The first prophetic voice was from a woman. Her name is Anna. And she's the whole scope of what God spoke to me. She was a prophetess. See, we're used to prophets as men walking and operating under that capacity, but few as women. But she wasn't a prophetess like we see today that comes in with a big frilly dress, all kinds of hankies. She's oiled herself down with frankincense and myrrh from Israel called anointing oil. She bought it at the local bookstore. She has her best CDs. She even has her own secret code to decipher the word of knowledge for you. She functions in the secret, the hiding, the weird, the fruity-tooty. Had a lady one time tell me that she was called to be our overseer. And I went, that's interesting, because half the time you're up in the mountains hiding out for 3 or 4 months. Your family's in disarray. Your husband really don't like you. That's why he don't care if you go to the mountains. I'd send you up there also. And you're going to be the prophetic voice in our life. You're going to be the overseer that we're going to submit to. I think not. See, that's fruity-tooty. But this lady wasn't, and I'm going to show you why. Go with me to Luke chapter 2, verse 33. And I guess many times it's because people that may have that gift have never either given themselves to leadership or never had a leader to teach them and instruct them properly and raise them upright. Let me tell you, everything that says it's a prophet doesn't. A lot of it's just pathetic.
Amen.
Amen? Watch. What's okay, I got to stay on track because I'd like to go down that rabbit trail and get lost. Luke 2:33, look at this. And Joseph and his mother marveled. Not his wife. Look, and Joseph and his mother marveled at the things which were spoken of him. That maybe was his mom, meaning Mary. Verse 34, then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother. Yeah, so it was his mother. Behold, this child is destined for the fall and rising of many in Israel and for a sign which will be spoken against. Verse 35, yes, a sword will pierce through your own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. That's interesting. Just like last week we had a baby dedication, this was Jesus' baby dedication. He was being confirmed. And in the law, you went before the priest, and the priest blessed you and confirmed you as a baby. They also had 8 days you were circumcised. I think we're going to just instate that again today. Bring me a knife. Put this in your notes. During this time, Simeon's blessing the baby. I taught a little bit last week. When you say blessed to something, the word literally in the Hebrew means commissioned to prosper and have great success. So when you say to somebody, be blessed, I know we say it flippantly. It's kind of like a salutation. You know, a nice enunciation, but it's greater than that. It's commissioning their future to literally suck in prosperity, well-being, wholeness, completeness, to where they lack nothing, to be blessed. Turn to your neighbor and say, blessed. Be blessed. Turn again and say like you mean, be blessed. Amen. There's been times I meet people in the city and I go, be blessed. And then they look like, hey. I go, no, be blessed. No, I mean, really, I want you to be blessed. Amen. Amen. Now, you guys ready for the insight? You can study part of it for yourself. Numbers 26, verse 44 through 45. Genesis 49 through verse 20. Deuteronomy 33 and verse 24. And what you're going to study is about this hidden tribe or lost tribe, I should say, of Asher. Or Asher. Right? Or if you speak Hebrew, Asher. Okay? It means happy. It means to be happy. How would you like to be a tribe known Asher as happy? I'm happy. I bet the leader of this whole tribe went, do you ever feel like a room without a roof? That song, I love that song. I'm happy. You can't be down, out, and mad at your neighbor when you hear that song. If so, you're demonized. Amen? You just can't do it. I'm happy. My wife has a song. It's like, what do you call it? Deep house. Her and my son exchange songs. It's like music. And it's called Deep House. And every time I hear this element of this chorus line and the way they arrange the music, I just start smiling and I start laughing. Every time Larry is driving around with us, going to dinner or wherever we take, you know, running him around, that song will come on, and I am in the back laughing my bottom off. I am literally laughing hysterically. And then she does this little thing with her fingers, you know, because she's all into it. And so I look at Larry and I go, she'll get Larry doing it. I'm like, this is hilarious. A 6'5 guy, prophet to the nations, ambassador, doing all this stuff with his hands as we're driving around Fresno. It's worth selling tickets to, trust me. So I usually videotape him and then send him, you know, with my camera, take a movie of him, and then I send it to him so he can see himself. And my wife always says, guess what? One day that's going to be our praise and worship. He's like, really? Yes. Anyways, watch this. The tribe Asher means happy. He was the eighth son of Jacob, hardly ever talked about. But as you would see, you know, the 12 tribes of Israel, they all had 12 stones to represent them. The one that represented this tribe was Tarshish. We call it beryl or amber. It's a very precious stone. When I was in preaching in Prague, amber is everywhere in the stores. It's very beautiful and not. It doesn't look the same. Has kind of the same color, but the veins throughout it is totally different. And you can get in all various sizes. So I asked him, tell me about this gem called amber. And it's made from pitch. Pitch out of a tree. But over time, it's hardened. And through the elements and through heat, it turns into a gem. It's incredible. It's incredible. And so this is the stone that represents this tribe. Now watch, it's interesting that it would come through that process into gemhood, if you would, because the other thing attributed to this tribe is the olive tree. Because they were makers of olive oil. You're a bunch of gems. See, you see things in a glimpse, and God's looking at the breadth of it. Amen. It doesn't stop there, it gets better. Sometimes it's good to get woken up by God. Watch this. So they associated this tribe with the olive trees because the land that they were summoned to was filled with olive trees. So they started to understand what this fruit would produce, which was oil. They didn't know that that oil would be used in priestly service. And they wouldn't know the vast use of olive oil, even to this day. But God gave them that insight. and that attributed to their wealth and their well-being. Turn to your neighbor and say, Asher. Amen. Here's their attributes. You want to know what they were about? See, your attitude and your expressions talk about your character. And your character, your expressions, and your attitudes go way before you. Amen? Happiness, contentment, richness, affirmation. They were known as a tribe that didn't need to be affirmed on the outside because they were affirmed from within. They saw their value from the inside out, not the outside in. Let me get it going here. I'm like a bull rider about ready to jump on a bull.
Go for it.
Check this out. So with this, their daughters were beautiful. Ladies, say amen, Pastor, bring it. Because I present to you, God doesn't make junk. Everyone's beautifully and wonderfully made, Scripture says. So you may feel like you're not the trend or in, but God says you're wonderfully and beautifully made. Celebrate your uniqueness. Amen? What you need to do is look in the mirror and say, this is the next trend, baby. Amen? You need to go to your husband and say, take a good look, this is the next trend. Right? That's right. Ladies, you need to get your shabang, shabang on. Come on now. Just with your husband now. Come on. You need to walk up to him and go, jingle bells, jingle bells. It's Christmas time up in here. And as a good husband, you say, let me unwrap the present. Amen? You didn't know it was so fun to come to church. Watch this. But the daughters of this tribe were of good reputation. They just didn't give themselves out like peanut butter jelly to everybody. They were reserved. You don't know that song, spread it like peanut butter jelly? Well, that has several meanings. And these ladies were well kept because they esteemed themselves of great value. Watch what the outcome was. Because of this mentality that was this inner revelation as to who they were and how God had blessed them, they were highly sought after as wives by priests and kings of the land. This is why, ladies, when Mr. Joe Schmo shows up, you say, sorry, can't touch this. Prophetic word. Take a credit application, a financial asset sheet to see if they're qualified to take care of you. Amen? Because I'm telling you, if you are not married, you need to believe God has a man in white shining armor, meaning clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ, that will be your headship. I understand why women can't submit to some of these men. I wouldn't submit to them. I'd kick them in the buns. I would beat them into sleep. Come on. Men, if you want a woman to follow you and submit to you as her husband, right, and join with you, give her something to follow. She ain't marrying a baby. She's already had that, been around that. Amen. Okay, here's a prophetic word. When I'm looking for a husband, if I have to change his diapers, that is called trouble and detour. Does that make sense? Sometimes we're marrying projects, wanting God to just change them. Go, no, he's looking at you going, sister, just listen. I have a priest for you. I have a king. Why? Because men and women of God, let me present this. In the New Testament, we are called to be kings and priests of the Most High.
Amen.
Somebody that beats with your heartbeat. Somebody that resonates and vibrates with the same message as you do.
Amen.
Are they out there? Oh, yes. But gems aren't everywhere. You got to find them. And they got to find you. That's good preaching, man. Watch this. So these daughters understood that, and that's why they were literally sought after by kings and priests. They would go to this tribe because these girls were like, ooh, la, la. Now, let me give you another word. Now, I know this may not sound scriptural to all of you tuning in by television, but they were sensuous, sensual. Ladies, let me tell you something. You need to learn how to float your husband's boat. Because if you can float his ship, guess what? He'll always be at your harbor. Let me just crack this down a little better. Did you guys get it on that one? Okay. I'm talking about being gems now. Come on. I grew up in a church where you couldn't talk like this. Like, the devil's entered him. I would say sex to my grandma that was a Pentecostal holy roller with the bun and the long dress and the hairy legs. And she would go, the devil. I'm like, how in the heck did I get here, grandma? You're not Mary. You got that. True story. So I grew up in a church where we couldn't talk about sex. So guess what people were doing? Sex! True story. People are going to get the revelation. Anyways, they were sensual. Now, watch this. Here's what the world will always do to the beauty of God. The occult, as you'll see as I tell you the last part of this, took the picture, if you will, or the model of these ladies and used it for their, what do they call them? Goddesses. And you see that in European history and in European art. Because these ladies were so beautiful from this tribe. So the goddesses of the occult used their tribe as the template of what beauty was, and they made their goddesses in the attributes of these ladies. Okay? Now, moving on. Here's the other thing these ladies like, and this tribe is known for, the men as well. They like luxury. That's not a bad thing. Drew, that's cool. That's my tribe right there. You're it. They like luxury. Good health was another thing they were known for. Fresh air. They loved fresh air. You're going to understand why in just a second. And they exercised. Wow. Imagine. So this is what went with this tribe. Watch. They were easygoing and calm. See, if you're exercising, if you're taking in fresh air, if you're living in good health and the luxuries that God wants to give you, you can be calm and easygoing. This is why he says live in peace. The word peace is all-encompassing. It encompasses health, nutrition, well-being, whole, and prosperity. Having all the bills paid. So you can say, Bill, don't live here no more. Amen. Amen. You ever hear that song? Love don't live here anymore. Change it. Bill, don't live here no more. Why? You're living debt-free. Why? The prosperity of God is hunting you down and overwhelming and overtaking you. Amen? The well-being of God. This tribe was amply supplied because they were selling olives and olive oil. Watch. It gets better. You want more? I'm almost finished. Watch this. They're men. Come on, men. Oh, yeah. Come on now. Yeah. Watch this. The men of this tribe were warriors known as, you always hear about the mighty men of David. You don't hear about these people. Watch. They were known as the pride of Israel. These men were luxurious. These men were fit. These men understood how to take care of their wives. These men were known as the pride of Israel. The warriors of this tribe had this theme ascribed to them by the other tribes. They were almost a royal mascot, if you could say it that way. They were successful in commerce. They understood enterprise. They were generous. And they were known in the straits of trade and then the roots of trade as generous and good to deal with. They were honest and integrous. We always hear about the tribe of Judah. But this tribe had some great characteristics. They were called honest and fair. Now, you want to know where they lived? Of course you do. Here's where they lived. They lived along the coastal seashores. They were assigned the properties along the seashore. The seashore was a great land, a coastal region. And because of it, it had mild climates. They lived off of fish and olive oil. They had a great diet. So it was a very peaceful land. It was filled with olive trees. And it almost looked like if you went out to the outside of East Clovis here, but with olive trees. I want to think is a little prettier, but... Or we could say maybe along the coastal shore, San Simeon area is kind of what that landscape looks like through there. It's known as, and you'll love this, the Seas of Galilee. Have you heard that? It's the region of Galilee. Yeah. Moving on, check this out. You were there, huh, Hecla? Watch. Very rich and fertile soils. This is what they were given. It's crazy. Now, because they lived on the seashores, they traveled up and down the straits. And here's what even gets more interesting to me, is they went through the straits in their commerce and trade into the Arctic Sea. I'm sorry, the Atlantic Sea, Atlantic Ocean. Now, they didn't stop there. You want to know what their bloodline is? Thank you. I'm glad you came to church today. She's the only one who said, yeah. This is my friend over here. Watch. Their bloodline is all throughout Scandinavia, Scotland, Ireland, Canada, Denmark, Iceland, Switzerland. This is me saying, these are people that study blood, the DNA, right? Switzerland, Netherlands, Austria, Sweden, Finland, Luxembourg, Puerto Rico. Isn't that amazing? Somebody's ship got lost. Can you imagine sitting around the campfire? Well, you know, we sent Jehoshaphat that way. I hear tell that he understands what burritos are about. I don't know what a burrito is, but heard message about it. Anyways, Puerto Rico, Colombia, and Guatemala. They have taken their blood and through the DNA been able to trace it back to this tribe. Let me tell you something. We as gems are looking in our present time, dealing with present day enemy, present day discouragement or detours. But God's looking at generations that will flow from you, generations that will hear about you, generations that will hear about Him through you. Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, I'm a lot bigger than I look. Amen. When He made the promise to Abraham that his lineage would be this like the sands of the seashore, it was so profound. It didn't lock it into a region. It sent it all over the world. Amen? Amen? People want to talk about Genghis Khan. I want to talk about Abraham and how my God spread His word prophetically through one man and woman throughout the entire world. You are actually a benefactor of Abraham's faith before Jesus came to the earth. Read the New Testament. It says it like this, that we are engrafted into the seed of Abraham by faith. Not the working of your own. That's amazing. And I think God just put that in there so none of us got puffed up and prideful. Amen. Watch this. So that's his bloodline. And then let's put it with this. Go to this verse. I love it. Isaiah 45:3. Turn there. Is this good so far? Amen. Do you like this kind of teaching? Do you like? Is this good? Amen. All right. Praise God. Praise God. Is this good? Do you like this? It's wonderful. Amen. Hit him and tell him he's got a good pastor. I give you the proof. Just punch him. Let him know. No. Watch this. Watch. I love this. Watch this verse. And I hope that for 2016. I need one of those cookies to solve my problem. Anyways, 2016. Isaiah 45:3. I will give you, put your name there. I will give you the treasures of darkness and hidden riches of secret places. I'll never forget the day when my pastor, his wife, called me forward and she says, Darren, you'll no longer make bricks with mud and straw. For God's redemption's come to you and your home. It took a burden that was so hard for me to carry and just lift it off of me. And I begin to know this verse, that God has hidden things in dark places, this still treasure. And his riches are found in secret places that not everyone knows about. But if we have eyes to see and ears to hear, we can be commissioned to discover it and find it for his glory. He goes on to say that you may know, and that's the key. God wants us to know that we're his children. We're of his tribe. We're of his people. And that he's going to care for us and provide for us. And he's going to lead us to places of buried treasure. That you may know that I am the Lord who called you. Put your name right by that. And called you by your name. And I am the God of Israel. Think about that. You're a gem. You're precious. If we can allow God to change the way we think, we can experience greater things this next year than we've ever, ever imagined or had. But it starts with knowing. We've got to know. We've got to know God. And we've got to know that he's favoring us. We've got to know that he knows our name because we have an intimate relationship with him. And if we can know, we'll get the next part of it is we will know what is in reserve for us as his people. Because great and precious things are available. Mighty works and deeds. Jesus said, greater things shall you do than these. Amen. Greater things. He didn't pre-qualify the hearer. It was to all those that had an ear to hear. And that were willing to step by faith. Greater things shall you do. You were all personally commissioned through that passage to be carriers of a new covenant, a new testament to all mankind. He didn't pre-qualify you. He didn't look at limitation. He just heralded to anyone that would hear and receive. Close your Bibles right now. Holy Spirit, I thank you for your word. I thank you, Father, that from your vantage point, we're gems. From your focal point, we're precious and of great value. So, Holy Spirit, I ask today that this message would be seated in each one of us and that would be resident. That it would remain and it would begin to take root in our lives and produce this year as an unimaginable, unbelievable result for your glory. Lord, whatever you've called them to, I ask that this be the year that they fulfill it for your glory. If there be a fresh anointing needed, I ask that that would come upon them now. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. It doesn't matter how many times you've tried and haven't made it or failed. It doesn't matter. We're benefactors from inventors that just chose not to give up. They kept trying and trying and trying. Because the vision in their heart, the hope of their heart, was to produce something of great use that had not been accomplished. Many of them succeeded. The 1900s is laced with more inventions than almost all of mankind previous of ages. History tells us this. My question is what will history reveal about our generation? When people of the future are looking back, what will those history books record, and how will they know us? One man said it like this: a life worth living is worth recording. Your life is great, of great value.